Hello, welcome to the step-by-step tutorial on the development of 3D slicer extension. My name is Sen Li. Starting from this video, our custom module will be related with ultrasound sequence. We will discuss the code style, arrange method in the widget class and logic class, then develop an ultrasound sequence viewer in this video. In order to correctly load the ultrasound sequence files, we first need to install 3 slicer extensions about image guidance. Let's go to the extensions manager. In the tab, install extensions, we search for the keyword IGT. The extension slicer IGSIO, slicer IGT, slicer IGT link are the 3 extensions we have to install. Then we click restart. Click OK. Now, if we go to the module selection, we should see a category called IGT, which contains some ultrasound-related extensions. Let's load down ultrasound scene file. We go to our sequence viewer module, open our scene file folder, and drag the spine scene file to 3D slicer. Click OK, and now we can view the ultrasound sequence images. In the sequence browser drop-down list, we can select a different sequence browser node. We are currently at sequence browser 1. The slider under the drop-down list helps us view the recorded ultrasound sequence, image by image, and step by step. And we can always see the current frame index from here. There can actually be empty sequence browser nodes, which are created but not recorded yet. So, this is the module we are going to study together today. Before we study the Python script, we'll first talk about our code style. Make sure that our code is readable, maintainable, and robust. Then we will build a framework to group different methods in a class. We know that there are only 2 classes in a Python file we need to focus on, the widget class and the logic class. But there can be a lot of methods in each class. A good arrangement of methods in a Python script can simplify both code reading and programming. In the end, we will discuss about the GUI design and Python script optimization. We want our code to be readable, not only for the code readers, but also for ourselves to recall our memory after a long time. In case we forget why we call a function, or under what situation should we call a function, we already write detailed comment, and we don't write extraordinary solutions for ordinary problems. For the naming of methods and variables, we try to include as much information as we can. No abbreviation. We use camel case for a short phrase, and use underscore to connect the multiple phrases together to be the name of a variable or a function. We use string macro to replace any magic numbers or string. For variables only, we always start with the type of the variable and connect with underscore. Here's an example function in which we ask from the slider in the user interface for the index of the current selected image of the ultrasound sequence. From the comment, we know that this function is to make the code maintainable by using a function to avoid the magic number 1, which is replaced by the string macro int slider frame index minimum. The name of the string macro begins with the type int, and it contains 2 more phrases, meaning the minimum of the slider frame index. Regarding the robustness of the code, we will see a lot of test or assert statement in the beginning of a method. We can never have too many assert statements because you never know when there will be a bug. This is a backend update function. It is called when the current active sequence browser needs to change the selected item number. In our application, we can not only switch between different sequence browsers, but also switch between different 2D images, both within a sequence browser and across different sequence browsers. To make the selection switch work outside our module, this function only updates the backend data without any change in the user interface. To achieve the objective of this function, we simply need one statement to set the selected item number of the active sequence browser node. But you can see that this function checked the validity of both sequence browser node and the index to update, just to make this function robust. The second rule to enhance robustness is to use node reference to store a node. This is specific to 3D Slicer, but very important. There are three general methods to get a node in 3D Slicer, and the most used one in 3D Slicer Python Interactor is getNode. But we should not rely on this method in the module development, because there can be multiple nodes with the exact same node name. The second method to get and store a node is using the node ID. However, it can be fragile because the 3D Slicer automatically modifies the node ID when loading a new scene file. It can be fun using the node ID with the in one method call, as the user cannot add or remove nodes while a method is running. The best way to store a node for persistent node reference is to call the function setNodeReferenceID and getNodeReference. You can specify any string as a reference rule of your target node according to your own preference.
The third rule to make our module robust is to explicitly define functions related to the update of user interface and the update of parameter node. Let me explain by starting from the update of user interface. We mark this block as a function capital alpha, then mark the function with prefix UIUpdate_ as capital beta. We already learned from the last tutorial GUI Hello World about using the billboard underscore updating GUI from parameter node to avoid infinite loop of updating. As a result of this billboard, we must turn on and turn off this billboard in function capital alpha, and we must not touch this billboard in function capital beta. Otherwise, capital alpha will be messed up. Similarly, there are two groups of functions related to the update of parameter node. Each function from the group capital beta has a function name starting with parameter node update underscore. And each function from capital alpha will open a brace, call function beta, and then close the brace. Capital alpha must switch the brace, and capital beta must not touch the brace. This is an important rule to avoid infinite loops.
After the code style, it's easy to explain the method groups in our module. To arrange the method for convenient code reading and programming, we put the string macro on the top of the Python script right after the library import. We have four sections in the widget class. Section 1 includes the paired functions with prefix get or set, which retrieve or assign the class member values or user interface values. For the other value request functions, we use prefix obtain. Section 2 contains the update of user interface related functions, which include group capital alpha and group capital beta, as we introduced in the third rule to make the module robust. Similarly, section 3 contains the update of parameter node related functions. In the end, section 4 covers all the other functions. The only difference between the logic class and the widget class is that we don't have the update of user interface in the logic class. Now we should be able to read the Python script easily. Let's take a look at the graphical user interface. We click the button Edit UI. We can check the layout of the whole QMurmur widget from the Object Inspector. The class of the sequence browser dropdown list is QMurmurNodeComboBox, which can help us update the available sequence browser nodes whenever there is a scene file change. The other elements are all from the Qt library. There's one important thing to be noted is the signal slot editor. Yes, we can connect the signal slot in the Qt designer when editing the graphical user interface. We have two signal slots connected here. The first one is to pass the value of the slider to frame index label so that we can always see the frame index of the current 2D image in the active sequence browser. The second one is to let the sequence browser dropdown list update whenever there is a murmur scene change. If you forget to connect this signal slot, your module will not update when you load a new scene file. Great! Let's go back to the 3D slicer and compare our custom module, Ultrasound Sequence Viewer, with the sequence viewer in the existing module sequences from 3D slicer. Let's pay attention to the ultrasound image in both 2D widget red and the 3D widget. See the difference when we change the active sequence browser node from the drop-down list in our module. We can observe the change of the active ultrasound image. If you go to the sequence viewer given by 3D slicer, when we change the active sequence browser nodes, the ultrasound image did not update. But we can see the update of the time slider. This is not as user-friendly as our custom module. Only if we slide the time slider, change the selected value of the time slider, we can observe the update of the ultrasound image. This can be a small bug of 3D slicer, and we fixed this bug by using a small trick in our custom module. This is great, isn't it? You can find our small trick from the Python script in the GitHub link provided in the video description. We can also see that there can be a difference between the active sequence browser between our custom module and the module given by 3D slicer. We want the two sequence viewer to be synchronized because this mismatch can be confusing and not user-friendly. How can we synchronize the two sequence viewer and optimize our custom module? Let's go back to PyCharm. We are in the widget class function setup. Let's go to step 5, where we can connect the signal of slider module sequences toolbar active browser node change to our slot function unselected node change so that when the sequence viewer given by 3D slicer change, our module will update. We are not done yet. Let's navigate to the slot function unselected node change. Go to step 2, UI update. We set the active sequence browser node for the sequence viewer in the module sequences given by 3D slicer. In this way, the module will update the active sequence browser node for 2 times if we change the drop-down list, and will not cause infinite loops because after the second time update, there's not any change in the active sequence browser node, thus no infinite loops. In the meanwhile, the two sequence viewers can be synchronized at a low cost. Let's go back to 3D slicer and restart. We go to our module, open the scene file folder, drag the scene file to 3D slicer, and check if the two sequence viewers are well synchronized. When we change the active sequence browser node from our module, the sequence viewer given by 3D slicer updated. And when we change the active sequence browser node from the viewer given by 3D slicer, wow, not only two viewers are synchronized, but also the ultrasound image can update as we change the active sequence browser node from the sequence viewer given by 3D slicer. We fixed the bug. Let's make a summary. In this video, our custom module is related with the ultrasound sequence data. We want to make our code readable, maintainable, and robust. To keep our module robust, we want to use the node reference to store a node for persistent node reference. And we want to explicitly define functions related to the update of user interface and the update of parameter node. Using two groups, group capital alpha and group capital beta, for the update of user interface and parameter node, we can put similar functions together for better code reading and programming. Note that we can connect signal slot when we edit the graphical user interface. In the end, we synchronize two sequence viewers and fix the bug of no image update when we change the active sequence browser node in the sequence viewer given by 3D slicer. That's it. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave me a message and I will respond as fast as possible. I will see you in the next video. Thank you.